So the video is based on Bowman's strategic clock and where companies should strategically position themselves regarding the criteria of price and the perception of value added. So it has 8 positions on the clock, and what this video will highlight is what is the strategic focus on the set of positions, but with real life examples. So to begin with, let's consider position 1. Now this is low price and low added value. But just because it's low, doesn't mean the position will be unsuccessful. This position could work. If you are able to maintain low costs and there is still demand for such low quality, then it will succeed. Types of examples are the likes of discount shops, such as Poundland in the UK, Dollar Tree in the US, maybe even Daiso, the Japanese themed discount shop. So let's see an example.
Cash-strapped shoppers are flocking to dollar stores. And it's no wonder. Supply chain issues, record job loss, and high inflation means consumers are looking for a good deal. Dollar stores only sell cheap items, typically between $1 and $10. They sell food, clothes, and household goods. Before there were dollar stores, there were variety stores, often called penny or nickel and dime stores. Dime stores weathered the Great Depression when many other retailers were going out of business. But variety stores really took off in the post-World War II economy. The Ben Franklin chain was one of the most popular and served as the prototype for many discount stores we know today. K.R. Perry started out with a Ben Franklin franchise in Norfolk, Virginia in 1953, which built the foundation for what would be known as Dollar Tree. The first Dollar General store opened in Springfield, Kentucky on June 1, 1955, with the concept that nothing would be sold for more than $1. And in 1958, a 21-year-old entrepreneur opened the first Family Dollar in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Dollar stores had their origins in small towns and in the sort of outer suburbs of cities. And the way that Dollar General described it originally was, "We go where they ain't," which meant they would go and open in small towns that Walmart or Target wouldn't go to, where there was no large supermarket or large CVS or Walgreens or anything like that.
Dollar stores historically targeted low-income shoppers, but the turn of the century brought in a new demographic, middle and upper-middle-class consumers. With the success of the dollar store format, other discount retailers began popping up. In 2002, the Five Below chain was founded in Philadelphia. It remains one of the fastest-growing retailers in the U.S., selling all of its items for $5 or under.
They have really proliferated, especially in the years post-recession, right? So I think we also have to think about dollar stores as a kind of retailer that's really flourished after the 2008 recession and has really kind of been able to benefit very strongly from the market that recession produced.
In 2015, Dollar Tree acquired Family Dollar for $8.5 billion, making it the largest dollar store chain in the U.S. at the time by store count.
One of the reasons that Dollar Tree bought Family Dollar through a 2015 acquisition was because they knew that the $1 price point wasn't going to be able to survive forever. And so what they're really trying to do now is they believe that they've built up enough trust with customers that customers think about Dollar Tree as great value, not just $1.
So as we can see, low price, low perceived value. But that's accepted, and that's accepted because you know what you're getting. You know that there's better products out there, but because it's so cheap, it doesn't seem to matter. It's also considered to be the bargain basement. So what I mean by that is customers consider it to be a no risk. They consider it to be no risk to buy because of how cheap. So even if they don't enjoy the product, it hasn't cost them that much. So it's not a massive factor. Companies believe that there's no competitor that will want to undercut them, which gives them that dominant position in that position one category in terms of low-cost market. Now, these goods, when considering income elasticity of demand, they might be considered inferior goods with a negative YED. However, there is sometimes concern with how long you can remain in such a position for. Hence why Dollar Tree, perhaps by acquiring other companies, they were thinking about maybe moving towards position two. So what is position two? Well, position two is low price, but some perceived value. Now, Aldi could be a prime example. They're able to be seen as a cheaper alternative to the big four, and they still offer some perceived value. They carry out a cost leadership strategy, ensuring costs are low, and therefore they can offer those low prices. Perhaps this is the reason why maybe they're so fast in the till, serve as many customers as possible to have output as high as possible, but also whilst finding ways to keep costs efficiently low.
In 2014, Lidl ran this ad in response to a pledge by Morrisons, who claimed it could match some of their prices.
And the page was full, crammed with a massive tower of a list of the different steps one would actually have to take with Morrisons in order to enjoy the prices you could so simply enjoy with Lidl's.
Well, the advert was clever, it was funny, and crucially, it was really cheeky. It took the mickey out of one of the big boys, and it showed that however small they were not afraid.
By now, the established supermarkets had fully woken up to the threat posed by the two German upstarts, who continued to sell at prices they struggled to match. Behind the scenes at Aldi today, the keys to its success are clearly visible.
Aldi is all about simplicity and ruthless efficiency. It's substance over style. Products are displayed in cardboard boxes or left on the pallets themselves. So they can take the products directly from the lorry and place them right onto the shelf. Staff can quickly stock the shelves and get on with other tasks.
So when considering Aldi as an example, think about the products they sell. They target customers looking for cheaper alternatives to more expensive goods. They're masters at these types of goods, such as their version of wine gums, Mars bars, punk IPAs, or even Jo Malone. There is an acceptance that they do not equal the actual and original good in terms of quality, but it's a cheaper version. There is still quality perceived, and it's still a way of differentiating them, but it's a lower price. So other examples might be Primark in the fashion retail sector. Right, the next position is three. And three is the hybrid position. And this is where it's a moderate price and moderate perceived value. So IKEA is a prime example. Comparing them to other furnishings and furniture retails, they're often cheaper, but the quality is reasonable and the price is reasonable as well.
Your last trip to an IKEA.
They have the restaurant with the, you know, the Swedish meatballs and all this stuff. And that's not a coincidence. I mean, you're trying to build excitement because when people are excited and aroused, they're more likely to buy.
It's not a grab a carton of milk and get out kind of store. It's the opposite of that. It's very much set up to spend a day, think about rooms, you know, dream about what you really want your bedroom to look like.
The floor plan of most IKEA stores resembles a maze that curves about every 50 feet to keep customers curious about what comes next. Since an average IKEA store is around 300,000 square feet, or five American football fields, that means a lot of walking.
An IKEA is, to some, frustratingly winding. But really, it's laid out as an experience to get you to buy more.
So IKEA justify their price and are able to add value with their flat pack unique selling points, their day out experience, but also their sustainability. IKEA can also keep costs low. So for example, as a way of keeping costs low, in the past, they've acquired some of their suppliers and that's helped them to keep cost of sales low. But the whole experience of that you have to go through the whole shop before you reach the exit. And because you're going through all different parts of a house, so whether that's the kitchen, whether that's the living room, the bedroom, and all the goods are affordable, it almost creates this impulse purchase behavior. And because you also know the quality is reasonable and the price is reasonable, you're more likely to buy. Right, position four. Well, position four is highly perceived value, but alongside a justified high price. So therefore, there's clear value that is being added. This type of positioning is often in a mass market, as the price does not necessarily exclude segments. So I've used Nike as an example. So how did Nike do it?
Back to reality and speaking my name, I'm a bossy chick. In the Hall of Fame, but I be starting my stuff, get along with my dozen, not a gangster. ¿Crees que es la mejor temporada de tu vida? Pregúntame el año que viene. Real girls ball, fake girls talk, real girls shake, fake girls take it, rah, rah. I'm the one that's breaking, I'ma shake it to the ground, bring it back up, twirl it all around, yeah, you know what's up. Shake it, move to the ground, move it, move it, move it, bring it back up. Shake it, move to the ground, move it, move it, bring it back up. Shake it, move to the ground, move it, move it, move it, bring it back up. Shake it, move to the ground, move it, move it, move it, bring it back up. Move, move, move.
So Nike cover all sports, and all sporting attire is to a high quality. They associate it to many big sports clubs, which provokes thought. If I like that club, if that club is successful, then the branding of Nike must also be. So they're able to differentiate themselves by the involvement with sports, whether that's endorsements, sponsorships, or even celebrities design lines for them like Michael Jordan. They advertise how they embed technology and sports science into their designs. Now, position five is focused differentiation, and that links more to niche offerings. So let's have a look at an example.
In order for a Rolex to actually leave the factory or be a Rolex design, it has to be recognizable from 20 feet away. Hi, I'm Cara Barrett, editor at Hodinkee, the leading online watch publication. Rolex is one of the few brands, if not the only brand, that has a very specific aesthetic. They are sporty, they are active, they are tool watches. That's kind of their main DNA. In the 50s, they came out with the Submariner, the Explorer, the Milgauss, the GMT, and they were all watches that were designed and made to be used as tools. And so that's their bread and butter, and it still is today. It kind of evolved into a luxury brand later in life, which now is what they're known for. So that's kind of the interesting thing about them, is they initially were tool watches, which have now become luxury. Rolex is kind of one of those brands that sits on the lower end of the spectrum as far as luxury watches are concerned. The Submariner is $8,000. The entry-level watch at Rolex is $5,000, with the Oyster Perpetual. Their three qualities are self-winding, waterproof, and precision, and they really focus on quality. It takes 1 year to make a Rolex. They go through extensive testing, the accuracy, the chronometer, the timing. It's all about telling the right time, keeping the right time. They also have extensive service work after, so if you ever have a problem with your Rolex, you can take it to them and they'll fix it. The clasp is opened and closed 1,000 times before it leaves, so you know that when you get it, it's not going to break. The whole point of a Rolex is you buy one now, it will last you for 20 years if you take care of it. It'll last you for 100 if you really take care of it. That's ultimately why they're so expensive, because you're buying something that will last you a lifetime.
So position five and focus differentiation is a very high price, which may limit the segments targeted. However, as it is perceived as such high quality, there will always be demand. You would argue that these goods are potentially price inelastic in demand, as they're so unique and such high quality. If price rises, the responsiveness will be minor. So as it is highly targeted segments, they know customers are willing to pay a much greater percentage, more than what they would pay for basic watches and the economy competitors. Right, now we've reached the final three positions. We've got 6, 7, and 8 to go. Now these are often strategies destined for ultimate failure. So position 6 is named as risky high margins. Now, risky high margins, what that means is, because it is high price, but quality is questionable, and if customers are questioning the quality, then they will not pay the price, hence why it is destined to fail. Now, if I was considering it from a Boston Matrix point of view, I wouldn't be surprised if firms, after launching it, would quickly realize that it's a question mark or a problem child. And obviously, these question marks and probably trials will probably turn into dogs. Now, a perfect example is the Apple Newton. Now, the Apple Newton's performance was considered weak. It should have been innovative. It should have revolutionized the market, but it was a flop. It had little functionality and better technological improvements were needed. In fact, when Jobs returned to Apple, he quickly withdrew it.
I tried a Newton. I bought one. I thought it was bought one of the early ones. That was a piece of junk. I threw it away. I bought one of the Motorola Envoys, the wireless thing. I thought it was a piece of junk after using it for 3 months and threw it away. I hear the new ones are a lot better. I haven't tried one. I've sort of been, what's that? Try one? Yeah, I will. But see, here's my problem. My problem is, to me, the high order bit is connectivity, right? The high order bit is being in touch, connected to a network. That's why I bought the Envoy, had a cellular modem in it. And I don't think the world's about keeping my life on this little thing and IRing it into my computer when I get back to my base station. I think that to me, what I want is this little thing I carry around with me. It's got a keyboard on it, because if you do email, you need a keyboard until you perfect speech to speech recognition. You need a keyboard. You don't sit there and write stuff. You need a keyboard. And you need to be connected to the net. So if somebody would just make a little thing where you're connected to the net at all times, you got a little keyboard like an eMate with a modem in it, I'd love to buy one. But I don't see one of those out there. And I don't care what OS it has in it. So, I don't want a little scribble thing. But that's just me.
So in considering position 7, this one can create animosity and disdain towards the brand. If they are a monopoly or have monopoly power, and they're aware of their dominance and they exploit it by overpricing products, then customers will not perceive the value as they believe they lack choice. So in the 1990s, Microsoft Windows operating system did just that. They charged unreasonable prices for the patent license and information fee, and that caused, again, that, I suppose, that disdain that I was talking about earlier, where they believed that they were being kind of overpriced and it wasn't worth it, and they didn't really appreciate the monopoly power that Microsoft Windows were obviously exploiting. Now, the eighth position. The eighth position is the worst position, and the reason being is because it results in lost market share. Now, BlackBerry's might be an example of such a position. Obviously, when BlackBerry's were at the height, they would not have been considered that, because they would have been a high quality perceived value with a high price. But they continue to produce and offer their products at similar prices even after smartphones were released. And the smartphones were far superior, and therefore without such adaptions and technological improvements and development, they were never going to be good enough. So whenever a company is in this position, they should consider withdrawal. So withdrawal from the market, probably because it's reaching the end of its product life cycle. It might be a consequence of strategic drift. So in other words, a failure to keep up with the market changes. But it is deemed a high price, and the value, there is no value which is perceived. So when we look at BlackBerry, obviously they've come to an end now, and they've removed such phones.
The end of an era. Moment of silence for dear departed BlackBerry. Starting today, the BlackBerry classic device, once a go-to for millions, including then-President Barack Obama, will no longer work.
Yeah, during its heyday, the BlackBerry was the device to own, a phone that defined a generation. It was quite the status symbol. Mm-hmm. Speaking of status, NBC's Carrie Sanders joins us with more. Hey, Carrie.
Good morning. Yeah, I mean, depending on your generation, this was it. That iconic keyboard that really changed the way we communicate. I mean, this here replaced this. Remember these guys, flip phones, which at some point replaced these bag phones. Yes, kids, there were phones once that were in bags. But today, as you noted, the classic BlackBerry is going dark. Rest in peace.
Before Apple, there was BlackBerry. From presidents and politicians to celebrities and CEOs, the phones with the signature keyboard quickly became a status symbol at the office and beyond. But now, decades later, those phones are shutting down. BlackBerry discontinuing service for its classic model starting today, saying they will no longer reliably function.
All good things come to an end.
At its peak in 2012, the company reported having 80 million active users.
The BlackBerry used to be one of the most popular phones in the world. It was easy to understand and use. It also had those keyboards that were really clicky and tactile.
People everywhere were glued to their keyboards, which made answering emails for work.
All essential personnel will be issued BlackBerries for company use. Gimme, 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 gimme.
Or messaging friends through the phone's popular BBM platform, easy and addicting. BlackBerries became crackberries for many. but eventually that once revolutionary keyboard became obsolete.
They all have these keyboards that are there whether you need them or not to be there. What we're going to do is get rid of all these buttons and just make a giant screen.
With the rise of the touchscreen, Apple's iPhone and other devices took over. And while BlackBerry tried to adapt with its own giant screen and new operating systems, the company came up short. The new